Okay, all right, guys, I think we'll start. All right, so guys, welcome and thanks for joining this class. I think I will talk a little bit about myself and this course, and then since the number is too big, I don't want to go individually through all of you guys, but if I can get a few one line in the chat window about who you are and what you're looking from this class, that will be great. I'm not going to go through each one of you because that's going to take at least half an hour time. So this is a pretty big class. I'm not surprised. When I did my last Amazon class, there were around 27 people joined for the class, and then around 18 people attended my class. There is a reason for it, because Amazon Cloud is becoming one of the hottest topic in the IT industry at this point. Every company is one or the other way is looking to move to cloud, and they wanted to do something in cloud. And one of the good thing is this technology is very hot in the industry, and it is pretty new. And there are not many people in this industry at this point. And this is always, you know, cutting edge technology, we could say. Anyways, guys, my name is Cherian. I think you should call me Cherian. That is what I would prefer. So call me Cherian. I have around 20 plus years of IT industry experience. I, after finishing my engineering in electronics and communication, in 1995, I went to Bangalore, and then actually I learned Microsoft Windows NT 4.0, 3.5 and 4. That is what I started my career as a system administrator, and this was in 1996. So 96 to 99, I was in Bangalore. I was working in Bangalore. I worked for one of the startup online group buying portal. This is the time the dot-com boom was starting. So my first job was a web administrator working for a online portal company in India, in Bangalore. And then I joined a company called Digital India. I don't know how many of you know Digital. Digital was one of the largest company in the world at that point. Later, Digital was taken over by Compaq. And then Compaq was taken over by HP. So I came to US in 1998 through Digital in Connecticut, and I was working for Unilever for almost 4 years. And then I moved from Connecticut. I left, so by that time it was HP. And in 2002, I left HP and I joined Merrill Lynch Investment Managers, one of the largest asset management firm in the world, today part of Bank of America. And from there on, you know, I did move a couple of companies. Currently, I work as a virtualization cloud architect. Primarily, last 12 years, I was doing deep dive work in the VMware virtualization platform. And I think many of you know who are in this class also. I mean, at least four or five people in this class who have attended my VMware classes in the past. I've been training VMware virtualization for the past 8 years. It's a long time. I've been training VMware, and even now I do training in VMware. But what's happening now is technology is changing, so as everybody. I've been working in Amazon tech cloud technologies for the past 2.5 to 3 years, I would say. 3 years I've been looking into it, but the last 2 years, I would say probably I am pretty much spending almost like 60 to 70% of my time into Amazon cloud infrastructure, because that was one of the primary goals of our company. And we are at this point, the company that I work, I also do some consulting work. We are actually into cloud. a good presence. So we are looking at something like a hybrid cloud. So we'll talk about what is cloud, we'll talk about what is private cloud, public cloud, we'll talk about what a hybrid cloud is. And a hybrid cloud is something that is actually momentum at this point. I see a lot of companies are trying to do some kind of a combination of a public and a private cloud. So Amazon AWS, this is my fifth batch, and I'm seeing that the interest on this topic is very demanding now. In fact, this class now, I see around 15 people in this class. There are 23 or 24 people registered, you know, so things can change. So the thing is that there is a lot of people are showing interest in this topic, and there is a reason for it, because every company is looking for Amazon experts at this point, because they are all in the process of testing out or trying out what is there in Amazon. So you know, I just wanted to tell a story about what is happening in the industry. So if you look at around in 2007-2008 time period, if you're looking for a position in Dice or Monster or any job portal, if you're working as a Windows administrator or a Linux administrator or a storage administrator, you could always see that in 2007-2008 time period, in the requirements job description, you can see in the bottom there was a one line that says knowledge of virtualization, especially VMware virtualization, and I will talk a little bit about VMware virtualization. VMware virtualization is definitely the number one virtualization technology in the industry. 90% of enterprise companies are using VMware virtualization at this point. There are competitors for VMware. Microsoft is there, Citrix is there, KVM is there. is there? Excuse me. So Amazon is no doubt the leader in virtualization technology. So in 2007-2008, if you're looking for a job requirement, you would always might have seen in the requirements, it says in the bottom, understanding and knowledge of virtualization is a plus. It was a plus point. If you're going for an interview and if you know virtualization in 2007-2008, it was definitely a plus point. Then in 2009-2010 time period, what happens is that plus has changed to a must. If you're looking in positions for Windows administrators, storage administrators, or Linux administrators, you could have seen that the requirement says understanding and knowledge of VMware virtualization is a must, because 90% of the enterprise companies were using virtualization. When I started working in virtualization, my first experience in VMware was VMware ESX Server 2.5. That was in 2002. That was the first time Merrill Lynch was implementing VMware virtualization, and I'm very fortunate and lucky that I got into that project, and I was one of the key lead developer in setting up Merrill Lynch's VMware platform across the globe. So that gave me a lot of experience, and even today I work heavily on VMware virtualization technology. Remember, in 2002 VMware version was 2.5, and today VMware's latest version is 6.0. I know many of you guys in this class who are attending my class now are VMware experts and people who are working in virtualization technology. VMware has moved from 2.5 to 3 to 3.5 to 4, 4.1, then 5, 5.1, 5.5, and now the latest and greatest version of VMware virtualization technology is 6.0. I did actually two classes of 6.0, but the last two classes consecutively, January and this batch, I'm doing Amazon. I cannot do two classes at the same time. So a lot of people are actually calling me, when am I starting my next VMware class? And hopefully after this, I will be doing a VMware vSphere 6 class. So what I'm trying to tell you here is in 2010 and 2011 time period, job requirements clearly says understanding and knowledge of VMware virtualization, or in, I think there was no other virtualization, so I would probably say VMware virtualization was a must. But if you look at now, from 2014 and 2015, if you look at the job requirements now, you see a new phrase at the bottom of every job requirement that says understanding of Amazon AWS cloud infrastructure a plus. Every company is looking for Amazon guys, and that plus has changed, I would say, to a must today. If you look at today in 2016, many companies are hiring people. If you are a VMware guy or a Windows guy or a Linux guy or a networking guy or a storage guy, I'm sure they're going to ask you your expertise in Amazon Cloud, because every company is looking at it. So it has become a, from a plus to a must has become. So technology is changing in rocket speed, and you know, these things are happening very fast. So I would say, you know, you guys are here and you are going to listen to what I'm going to talk today. Hopefully that will give you a very good solid understanding of what is Amazon Web Services, what is Amazon Cloud, and probably you will be able to make a good decision where you want to move forward. Now, cloud is a very big generic terminology. Don't think that cloud means one simple topic, just like, you know, one product. No, cloud is a much more bigger terminology. So understanding cloud, the different aspects of cloud, the different areas of cloud, and making a decision where in cloud, what should I learn, what are my interests, what I'm learning, is it good for me, do I get a good job, do I get good money? And I think hopefully in this class, by end of this today's session, you will be able to get an answer for that. And that is what I'm trying to do. So this is not, probably I would consider this as a demo, but you know, I normally say this is my first class. This is absolutely the first class. I will not be repeating anything that I'm talking today in my next class. The class is going to move forward. So you could possibly consider this as a demo, an introduction session, and also give you an overview of what I'm going to teach. And I also request you to please ask as much as questions you have. I know you all will have a lot of questions, so feel free to ask questions, and then I will try to answer it as much as possible in my way of moving forward. Okay. So I'm not going to talk about many other things. I think I would probably jump into the Amazon Cloud, and then let me talk about what it is and all about it. Before that, I was I just wanted to show you something here. I was just doing a DICE search. This is DICE. Everybody know what DICE is. I just typed AWS in DICE, and just for New York, and you can see that, you know, there are around 288 positions for Amazon. It is so hot and so thing. You can see that senior AWS architect. This is exactly that I am teaching. AWS engineer, this is the exact same thing. Then DevOps is another thing. As you know that, you know, we do have other trainings that I am offering. I do have a training specific website, and that site is called solvingsys.com. I will put this in the chat window. You guys can actually take a look at it when you get some free time. Take a look at it. Insolvingsys.com is actually my company that is completely focusing on the training side of the business. We do provide a lot of training. Mostly, you know, this is all things that evolved over the past 4 or 5 years. You know, initially I was doing my own VMware classes, And then I started doing Windows classes. But now, you know, just by myself, I cannot do more than one class at a time. But even Windows Active Directory and Windows Server 2012 and 2008 is still very hot, and I still get a lot of people contact me for that classes. Anyway, these are some of the trainings that we are offering now. And out of that, there is a VMware vCloud Air. This is VMware's cloud, which is also taking a lot of momentum. I'm sure soon that will become one of the primary cloud providers in the industry. Apart from that, another class that you might have got my email, you know, there is another friend of mine. He was a very close friend of mine. He is actually the owner of or the blogger for the site called /root.in. This is one of the most famous Linux blog site in India. I think around 10 to 15,000 hits happening on this site. This site is owned and operated by my friend Sharath. Sharath is a Linux architect and a cloud DevOps architect. Sharath is actually doing the DevOps classes for me. I know somebody is asking that question. So advanced Linux and professional DevOps is a special course that we are doing. It's a big class. It is around 65 to 70 hours. This class is actually divided into two sessions because it's called as ALPD 100 and ALPD 200. This class will teach you the in and out of Linux. Believe me, this class is still going on. This class is going to get over in another week, and then the new batch is starting on March 15th. The students that are attending this class, there are Linux administrators, Windows administrators. They called me and said, you know, that is one of the best classes they ever attended with respect to Linux. So if you want to learn Linux from the grassroots level to the advanced topics, I would definitely recommend this class. This class has a second section, or the module 2, which is actually called as ALPD 200, which is completely about DevOps. So if you go to this site, you will get the details of that thing course, and the complete module is there. So DevOps is another. What is DevOps? DevOps is actually the automation in cloud infrastructure. So I was asking Sharath, why don't you teach just DevOps? Why do you want to do Linux? Why can't we do Linux as a separate? And his answer was, you know, Linux is, there is no doubt, is the premier operating system. And in cloud infrastructure, I would say many companies are using Linux because of its capabilities for automation and things like that. If you talk about big data analytics, Hadoop and all, you know, Linux is actually the player there. So a good understanding of Linux is absolutely required in order to learn DevOps, basically. So that is the reason this class is clubbed into two modules into one, Linux, advanced Linux, and then DevOps. So apart from that, you know, this is the Amazon AWS Foundation course that I am doing. This is, we're calling it as AFC 100. This class will give you an in and out of understanding about Amazon AWS cloud infrastructure, which I will go through that. So the details of this is there. I think you might have already seen this class. Even though I said this class is 30 hours, this is not correct. In my last batch, the class went almost around 40 hours. It may be more. I mean, I don't mind even if it goes a little more, because my goal here is to teach you guys the nice way. And these classes are not like a typical consulting firms, you know, giving free trainings and giving them some kind of a capsule format to make you appear for an interview. That is not the intention of my courses. Not only this, all the courses that we are doing are very deep courses. You know, if you ask Larry Stanley, he attended my VMware class. If you ask, I think there are a couple of other people. I think Durga, Sekabandi, you know, these are all people who attended my classes. You know how deep I go in my VMware classes. So definitely you guys can expect a similar course from this one. So I'll be covering pretty deep in this to to cover everything. So there are other trainings. I'm not going to get into that. Cisco UCS and HP Blade Server class is actually going on. That is also getting over now. So Oracle Advanced Oracle DBA training. This is actually done by another friend of mine who is actually a main architect for Capital One. That is actually another very, very excellent class. So if you have any friends or anybody interested in this, let us know. So let us go back to Amazon. I know you're all here to learn Amazon. So if you look at this Amazon thing, you can see that, you know, if you look at, you know, PA, you know, I'm just typing, you know, in Pennsylvania, if you type, you can see that, you know, AWS Architects, AWS Developer, Monitoring Specialist. This is all, we'll be covering all these things, AWS Consultant, AWS, you know, you can see that AWS Architect. This is what we are learning. So there is a lot of openings here. And then you can see this Linux thing, you know, you see Linux is always there with Amazon. Amazon Web, this is more of a chef, this is more of DevOps stuff. So AWS is no doubt is one of the hottest topic in the industry, and there are so many jobs, and people are getting a job in this, and it is actually an interesting topic. Okay. So there are people asking me about labs. I will explain how the lab is, how we do this class. I wanted to go through all these things. So AWS, you know, Amazon, you know, the site that we buy the stuff, you know, this is owned by that same company, Amazon. Bezos is the owner of this company. But AWS, Amazon Web Services, is a completely separate division of Amazon. This is being managed by a separate team of people, and probably the world's largest cloud platform. We are not doing Hemanta. I'm not doing a DevOps. We're not doing DevOps in this class. DevOps is a separate course. This class will give you the in and out of AWS Cloud Infrastructure, where we will be learning about networking, storage, deploying VMs and load balancers and firewalls and securities and VPN and all those things. That is what is this class is all about. Automation of that is, once you learn this, you know where to automate, and that's the time you need to learn automation. Without understanding what it is, you cannot do automation. You cannot do DevOps. So first is you need to learn this first and then to the next level. So so that is it. So Amazon Web Services is the Amazon cloud thing. So if you want to get into this Amazon Web Services, let me just log in. So basically, to get into Amazon, you need to create accounts. You know, it's there is a lot of things free. I will explain all that in the class, how you can utilize this. I would strongly recommend each one of you to create an Amazon account if you do not have one. And then you guys have to play around with it. It is not very costly. Pretty much 90% of what Amazon provide is actually cheap and free for the first so many months. So if you want to use it and practice it, I would strongly recommend you to create your own account. And I will walk you through the process. So somebody asked me, am I providing any lab? No, I am not providing any lab. For my VMware, I have a pretty big lab in my office. I have around 12 HP ProLine servers. Those who attended my class know how big my class is. Maybe one of the biggest VMware lab is, from a class perspective, what I have is a pretty big class, which will give you a feel of a real enterprise infrastructure. That type of a lab I have, and I give complete access to the lab where students can even ILO connect to the servers using ILO, power off the server, power on the server, boot from the BIOS. Right from there, students have access to my lab. But when it comes to Amazon, I don't have anything in my office or in my house. You know, Amazon Cloud is in Amazon's data centers. Am I going to give access to that? No. So that is why I'm saying everybody who wanted to learn Amazon and Amazon Cloud Infrastructure, you should take your own account. And it is a very clean, straightforward process. So you have to basically go to Amazon, aws.amazon.com. That is the homepage for Amazon Web Services, aws.amazon.com. Once you go to aws.amazon.com, you have this console, which is called as the Amazon console, where you can actually log in as, let me show you that, hold on 1 second. So you can actually log into Amazon console. So what you are seeing right now in front of you is actually called as AWS console. This is where you do everything, and you can see that there is a lot of things here, and Amazon is keep on adding new technologies, new techniques, new features. You can see here itself, if you quickly look at it, you can see that, you know, DMS, it's a new product, it is in preview mode, it is coming up. Inspector is a new feature that's coming up. You can see that there are, you know, Elastic File System, which is a new feature that's coming up. Mobile Hub was a new feature that they just launched around a month back. Lambda, Cognito, these are all new techniques more from a software development perspective. So Amazon is keep on adding, and I think, you know, I was reading some article recently. Amazon added around 450 new features last year itself. Every month they release around 10 to 15 to 20 features. New tools, new features, new capabilities, they keep on adding, and they're growing very, very fast. Some of the major cloud applications like Twitter, Airbnb, Uber, Netflix. Netflix is completely, you know, how big is Netflix? The entire Netflix infrastructure is running on Amazon. And that is the only place you can run that type of application. Netflix cannot have their own data center and do what they are doing today. They need elastic capabilities depending on their need. A company like Airbnb or Uber or Facebook or Twitter, they need something like this elastic compute cloud. And Amazon is one of the leading providers of that. And no wonder these companies are all moving towards cloud deployments. So we'll talk about cloud, and I know I'm keep on talking about cloud, but before getting into it, let me give you a quick overview of what you're seeing here. As I said, what you're seeing in front of your screen is called as the Amazon Web Services console. Getting into it, you know, you have to go and sign in. You need to register it, and then once you log in, you will see all these things. So you do pretty much 90% of your stuff from this window or this panel. You know, this is the control panel, or this is the web console. Amazon is so big, they have a presence globally, and their data centers are located in different parts of the country. And they call these different locations as regions or Amazon regions. So if you look here in this top right side, you can see that right now I am connected to the North Virginia data center or the region. It's not data center, actually, we call it as a region. So if I click on this drop-down button, you can see the complete regions of Amazon. Amazon has these many different regions. North Virginia, North California, Oregon, these are the three different locations in the United States. They have two locations in Europe, Ireland and Frankfurt. Another one in Germany is actually in the process of getting built. They have data centers or regions in Tokyo, Seoul, Singapore, Sydney, and then one in South America. They are also building one in Beijing. They are looking at building one in India. So Amazon is growing very, very fast. I'm sure in the next 2 years, you're going to see another four or five more regions are going to come. When I say the word region in Amazon, you got to understand it is, do the Amazon in China. Yes, Amazon is there in China. They are just in the process of building one in Beijing. It's still not been publicly available at this point. They are coming up one in China very soon. So when I say region, you need to understand what a region is. A region is actually a specific region, you know, east or west or something like that. So US East is a region. US East is actually a region which is primarily based out of Virginia. Every region has multiple data centers, multiple separate physical data centers connected through high-speed fiber optic backbones. And these data centers are called as availability zones. We will get into the details of that. So Amazon has any, how many data centers? These are not the data centers, these are the regions, and each region has multiple data centers. So if I open up a new Google window, let me see, I can find out that and say, you know, let's go to Google, and just wanted to show you something. AWS regions, if you just do that, you can see the different pictures here. So for example, I don't know, you can see this picture. If you can see this picture very clearly, you can see that here you see this first picture that I am showing here. Can you all see the screen? If you look at this one, that is actually the US East region, Northern Virginia. In Northern Virginia, you see around here, and each of these availability zone A, availability zone B, availability zone C. This is an old picture. I'm in Virginia right now. They have actually five data centers or five availability zones. But what I'm trying to explain you here is each region has multiple data centers, and these data centers are called as availability zones, or in short, normally we say AZ. When we start talking about more and more of Amazon stuff, we will be using the word AZs. Okay, that AZ is down, this AZ is down. Can I create a load balancer between multiple AZs? So when you deploy, when you design the architecture for your applications, your multi-tiered applications, you have to have a clear understanding of what an AZ is, because Amazon is not guaranteeing 99.99911 nines. Actually it is like this 99.999, like 11 nines. That is the level of availability Amazon is guaranteeing you. But Amazon is not guaranteeing the complete 99 point availability for one data center. But they are guaranteeing you that this guarantee, they are telling that one of these data centers will be always available no matter what. Amazon had some outages. If you look at the history, you can see that Amazon had some outages in the past. But compared to any other companies or any other cloud providers, the availability and the service availability of Amazon is way, way above anybody else. So they are having multiple data centers. When they have these multiple data centers, you have to understand they are connected through high-speed fiber optic backbones. That means the latency between these two data centers are less than a millisecond. That high-speed connectivity is provided between these data centers. So when you are deploying a server or multiple servers, or you are deploying a multi-tiered application, you have to architect that application in such a way that you have a servers in multiple data centers. At the minimum, you should have servers in two availability zones. So for example, if you're going to deploy a web server, you know, let's say your company is a public facing website. Let's say you work for Citibank and you want to put the citibank.com website. You should not be putting it in one server here or two servers in this data center. You should put one here and another one here, and then you load balance them using some kind of load balancers. In Amazon has a load balancer called as ELB, or elastic load balancers. So this is the way you need to architect, and that is the way you need to deploy your applications. Tariq is asking a question here, is the availability zones are synchronous or asynchronous? Nothing like that. You know, synchronous or asynchronous and all is to do with your data replication. For example, if you're using SQL Server, and you know, the latest SQL Server technology is called as always on. In an always-on SQL cluster, you can configure your database's availability using synchronous and asynchronous data transfer. But these data centers are not synchronous or asynchronous. They are completely isolated, separate data centers. But there are certain services, for example, storage. S3 storage is synchronously available across all regions, or across all availability zones. So there are certain things, but when you put a server, it is not going to be available in another server. You have to create multiple servers, and then you have to load balance it. Anyway, I don't think we need to talk about those things right now. It will be too much technical, but I'm just trying to give you an understanding about what an availability zone and what a region is. So I hope you guys got an idea about what a region is and what an availability zone is. So understand one thing. Every region has multiple data centers. Some of them have two, some of them have three, some of them are even having five availability zones. So if you look at here, I'm connected in Virginia now. So I'm going to the Virginia and then I'm going to the EC2 here. I just wanted to show you something here. I'm right now in the EC2 dashboard, or we'll talk about what is EC2 and all those things. You can see here, it is showing that I'm in the North Virginia, US East. They are saying everything looks good. And you can see that the availability zones in Virginia. That means they have, right now you can see that there are four availability zones in Virginia. That picture that I showed only shows three. But here they have a US East 1, 1C, 1D and 1D. So what are these US East 1E, 1D and 1E? What are they? They are nothing but completely separate, isolated data centers connected through high-speed fiber optic backbones. So it is up to an individual or it is up to a company to decide where you want to deploy your servers. Do you want to deploy servers in both availability zones, or you want to do it only in one data center? If you are ready to take a risk, you can create only one. But when you are deploying a highly available solution, it is highly recommended that you deploy it in at least between two availability zones. Can we create load balancer for servers in same region? Absolutely, you know, you can create in same regions, or you can even create load balancers within a zone itself. You know, if you have a data center or a zone, you know, let's say this is one of your availability zones, you can create two servers here in the same availability zone, and then you can load balance them also. Or you can create two separate data centers, or two separate, so this is AZ1-A. And this is AZ1-B. So you can actually create one server here and another server here. And now you can load balance them between two data centers. You can even do load balancing across regions also. For example, this is Virginia. And this is Oregon. These are two separate regions. You know, this is in the East Coast. This is in the West Coast. You can have a server here, and you can have a server here, and then you can do a load balancing. This is actually called geo load balancing. You know, you need to have a Route 53 and things like that. Can you do that? Absolutely, you can do that. If there is an atomic attack or atom bomb attack, or maybe a natural disaster, something like Sandy happens, and the entire East Coast is down, you can still have your application running from Oregon. So you can load balance your applications or design your application for high availability across regions also. So we'll be learning all that as part of the class, but I'm just, since you asked that question, I just got into that, Hemant. All right, so let's move forward here. So I wanted to go, so when you get onto the Amazon console, you have this icon on the top left side. You click on that, that is called as the console home. You click on the console home, you come into this window. So what are we learning here? Am I going to teach you everything that is showing here? No. So this class is actually the goal behind this class is actually this class is designed as a architecting AWS cloud infrastructure. Amazon has the certifications. Now, those who take my VMware class, the first question they come and ask me is, hey, Charyan, can I do certifications after taking your class? And my answer to them was no. Because if you want to take a Microsoft certification or I don't know about Microsoft, I'm not sure at this point, but I'm sure if you want to take a VMware certification, if you attend my class, you cannot take that certification. You have to go through official VMware course or you have to find some other mechanisms. There are ways to do that. I know there are students who have done that. You need to get some kind of a paperwork in order to do VMware certifications. But that's not the case with Amazon. You can do your Amazon certification after taking my class. Amazon do not have any official, I mean, they do have some training programs, but they are not restricting people. Okay, you should take our own training, then only you can take our certifications. Not, that's not correct. So Amazon has a lot of certifications. So this class will teach you AWS certification program. If you go here, you know, Amazon has so many things. So what I am teaching here is actually the AWS Certified Solution Architect Associate and probably a mix of these two things together, Solution Architect Professional. So Solution Architect Associate is probably, I would say, in my perspective, it is a course. The Amazon charges around, you know, you need to pay around $2,500 for this course. Just some basic concepts about what is cloud and what is thing. That is all it is. If you do that, so you need to do this associate certification first. And then if you want to do more, you need to get into architect professional. So my class is actually focused on these two courses together. I'm not going to do this as two separate classes. So by end of this course, I'm sure you will be able to attend the exams for these two courses. Now, as part of the class, I will provide you Amazon's course material. You know, it is... I have this. I will give you a copy of this. This is the actual Amazon Architecting AWS student guide. I will give a copy of this. So this is actually the first exam. You can see the different course contents, but this is not very detailed. This is how they put it, but I will be covering all these things as we move forward. So I will give you all these documents, everything, and you can actually use this to prepare for your exams. Now, preparing exams and understanding the cloud infrastructure and working on it is a whole different thing. No, I would say don't just learn for getting the certification. Rather, try to understand the concepts, try to understand each and everything, and try to do the practice and become a professional. That is how we need to look at it. So this course is actually Solutions Architect class, which will give you an in and out of Amazon's cloud infrastructure. So when we talk about this, you know, there is a lot of things. You can see that this is about compute. EC2, what is EC2? EC2 stands for Elastic Compute Cloud. EC2 means the 2C. It is actually EC2, though it is means that E and 2C. And that is means Elastic Compute Cloud. That is where you create VMs or servers in Amazon. If you want to create a Windows server or a Linux server or whatever you want to create, you have to go to EC2, EC2 Compute Cloud. That is where you're going to create virtual servers in the cloud. So we'll talk about that, how to create it. I'm not going to get into that now, but that is where you do it. The next thing is called EC2 Container Service. EC2 Container Service is more about, you know, automatic deployments of Docker and Docker containers. You know, Docker is another new hype in the industry, and you know, it's been one of the game-changing technologies that is coming up in the industry. Docker has been invented probably like 2 years back, and it has become so popular. Amazon is providing Docker. Even Microsoft started providing Docker services now. So you may definitely wanted to look at what is Docker, but you know, I'm not teaching Docker. This is more of scripting and automation and things like that. So that is EC2 container service. Elastic Bean Talks is more about web application development and things like that. That is not part of architecting AWS infrastructure. Lambda is again not part of this course. This is again more of running programs and stuff like that. More of, you know, I would say a scripting developer kind of thing is what these things. So in the compute, the main thing is EC2. And now understand, these are all small things. The big thing is EC2. EC2 is where you build servers, create servers, you create, you know, there's a lot of things to cover in EC2 itself. When we talk about EC2, you need to understand what an instance is. There are different type of instance is nothing but a virtual server in Amazon is called as an instance. When you learn VMware virtualization, we normally say VM or my virtual server. But in Amazon, nobody says VM or nobody says virtual server. In Amazon, a virtual server is called as an instance. So you can create instances and then you can start them, you can stop them, you can reboot them. And there are different ways you can create instances. There are different ways you can purchase instances. There are something like spot requests, reserved instances, scheduled instances. So we'll see all that. You will be understanding what is an AMI. AMI stands for Amazon Machine Images. We will see what an AMI is. How to create AMIs, how to deploy instances from AMIs. You'll understand about storage, you know, the elastic block storage concept, ephemeral storage. So there are different type of storage technologies here. So you will understand what is storage, what is volumes, what is snapshots. Security groups, that is all about network and security in Amazon. Security groups are nothing but firewalls in Amazon. If you are a VMware Amazon cloud architect or a cloud administrator, you have to have a very deep understanding about security groups, how to create security groups, how to manage security groups, how to provision ports and permission servers. You know, if you do mistakes there, you know, your entire infrastructure could be compromised. So a deep understanding about how to configure firewalls, how to create security in Amazon is very, very important. And you know that the biggest concerns for CTOs and CEOs in every big company is the security aspect of cloud. But that has been cleared now. You know, Amazon has every required certifications, security clearances. Even government organizations are now using Amazon. And you also know that Amazon has, I don't know whether it is showing here, let me see, it is there, but it's not showing here. Amazon has a .gov. There is a separate region itself for American government organizations. It is called as .gov. So we will be covering all that. You can see that elastic IP addresses, you know, placement groups. You will see the load balances, auto scaling, automatically scaling servers. You know, that is where the elasticity comes in. We'll talk about all that things when we get on to the topics in detail. So what I wanted to tell you here is just by clicking EC2 itself, you see that there is a lot of things. There is a lot of things that are happening here in this just one section itself, you know, understanding about VMs, creating VMs, deploying VMs, creating AMIs. You know, AMIs are nothing but, if you know VMware, you know what an AMI is. AMI is nothing but very similar to a VMware template. How to create templates, how to deploy from templates, understanding about storage, understanding about snapshots, how to manage these snapshots and how to manage these volumes and storage, you know, terabytes and terabytes of storage, how to deploy this storage, what are the best practices to deploy volumes, create volumes, you know, you want to get the best performance, how you can increase your IOPS on a server. So in order to do that, what type of storage I should use, how I should architect and how I should design my volumes. all those things you need to understand when it comes to storage. And then the network and security. So why I'm telling is, you look here, network and security, storage, and then a VM. So when it comes to cloud, there is no storage administrator. There is no network administrator. There is no Windows or VMware or server administrator, no. In cloud, there is only one administrator, and that administrator is called as a cloud administrator or cloud admin. A person who manages an Amazon cloud infrastructure for a company, no matter how big the company is, I would say he should know all these things pretty very good. He should know VMs, he should know how to create servers and deploy servers and manage the servers. He should know storage technologies. He should know networking. You need to definitely, networking and security here in Amazon is pretty very complex. You need to really understand what is subnet, what is routing table. You need to understand what is a network access control list, how to create security groups and policies. You need to understand about NATing, a lot of networking technology. So if you know what networking is, you're already good. But you know, you don't need to know all these things. That is what I will be teaching in the class. But what I'm trying to tell you here is, when you look at cloud, there is no separate service or separation of work. There is only one administrator. We call it as a cloud administrator. And by the end of this course, you will be a cloud admin, wherein you know how to deploy servers and create servers and manage servers in Amazon. You know how to create storage and provision storage and deploy storage solutions to different cloud servers. And on top of it, you will also understand about the different networking aspects of the cloud. So EC2 is one of the major topics here, and you will be learning. You know, I don't have any servers right now running, but I do have some servers that, no, I don't have anything. I deleted all of them, okay? Because this cost me money, so I deleted all of them. So EC2 is one of the primary focus on this class. Then the next thing is coming up is another storage technology, which is called as S3. S3 means 3S. Simple storage or scalable storage solution. A totally different storage technology, maybe you might have never heard. You know, we might have heard about storage. You know, you might have heard about NTFS file system, FAT file system, or EXT file system, or ZFS, or, you know, NFS, and these are all different type of file systems. But S3 is nothing like that. S3 is a completely different type of a storage technology, which is actually a new concept. It is called as an object-based storage technology. Object-based storage technology. S3 is pretty cheap. You can store terabytes and terabytes of data there, and it is not that very costly. Lot of companies, and especially these big companies like Netflix and Uber and all, actually take advantage of S3 storage. So we will be looking at how to deploy S3, how to create S3 buckets. In S3, we normally say it is buckets. So how do you create a different buckets, and how do you do all that things? We will see all that things in this S3 section. This is another big topic. There is quite a lot of things we need to learn about S3. CloudFront is, you know, if your company is like a Netflix kind of a term, or company, or your company is actually a IPTV company, how do you share your movies and your TV programs across the globe, or you have a high-end dynamic websites, how do you deploy your web server so that your contents will be up to date across the globe in every part of the country? You need to know about CloudFront. It is basically the content delivery solution from Amazon. So we'll talk about that. We will get an elastic file system. I won't be talking. That's a new technique. They're just they recently implemented. It is still in preview mode, so I won't be covering that. But If time permits, probably I can talk about that a little bit here. Glacier is another type of storage. We'll talk about what Glacier is. Glacier is even cheaper than S3. So, you know, if you're working in large financial pharmaceutical companies, you know, they have a policies that they need to store data for 7 years to 14 years. You know that, you know, these big financial companies will have petabytes of data, or maybe even exabytes of data. It's not in terabytes, I'm talking about petabytes or exabyte amount of data. Storing those much of data in costly storage arrays like EMC Isilon or EMC VMAX or VNX kind of storage arrays is, you know, unbelievable. It will be too costly. And you're keeping that for 7, 8, 10, 12 years for retention. You may not be even using that, but you need to keep that storage data somewhere. It may be emails from 8 years, 9 years, maybe tax-related documents from many years. So companies have these kind of compliance policies where they need to keep data for so many years, and which is a big challenge for every enterprise companies. Amazon Glacier is probably a good solution for that. Very, very cheap storage. And we'll talk about the pricing. Maybe a terabyte of data, if you want to store in Glacier, it will cost you probably 10 cents or 15 cents a month. 1 terabyte of data you can store in Glacier for 10 cents. Then why not take advantage of that? But there are some advantages to it. There are some disadvantages to it. But absolutely advantages is what you always see. But there are some disadvantages of keeping data there. For example, Glacier is a very slow responding storage. If you keep some data in Glacier, it may take probably a couple of hours for you to get your data back. So if you want the instant data, you want to have your data to be retrieved very fast, then you should not be storing in Glacier. And that is not it is meant for. It is meant for storing these kind of data that I mentioned, you know, for retention purpose. 7-year-old data, 10-year-old data, you can keep it there. Just for compliance. You may never even use it, but you can just throw it out there and it will sit there and you pay for, you know, in pennies. You pay for that and you will be, your data is secure there. You don't need to worry about storing it in costly EMC VMAX or NetApp storage arrays. We'll talk about import-export on Snowball. What is that technology? This is actually the one of the solution Amazon is providing in order to transfer data. Let's say your company is having 2,000 servers in your own data center and you wanted to migrate to Amazon. You want to move from your data center to Amazon. You want to move your 100 servers, which are today in your New York data center. You want to move that 100 servers to Amazon. How do you move it? Are you going to move it through internet? Are you going to move it through your VPN connection? No, it won't happen that way. It is these are big servers probably. So Amazon is providing a solution called a Snowball. You can do that. We'll talk about that. When it comes to databases, you know, so Amazon is all services. We'll talk about that. I know I just jumped into this, so I just wanted to quickly cover this and then we will move on to other topics. So we talked about compute. So when you say compute, you know, it's a generic term. You know, when you say compute, compute is actually a combination. Those who know VMware should know that. When I say compute in VMware, or in any virtualization technology, when somebody say compute, what does that mean? Anybody know? Can anybody answer in the chat window? When you say compute, what is that means? Okay, my server has this much compute power, or my VM is having this much compute. So what is actually compute? Okay. So what I actually Tariq said is actually the correct answer. Compute is actually a combination of CPU and memory together. When somebody say I have this much compute power means, that means I have so much amount of memory and processing power, CPU. That is what is compute. So typically in virtualized and industry, there are three major areas. One is compute, one is networking, and another one is storage. So compute here is all about virtual servers that is providing you memory and CPU so that you can run your applications. And then storage itself is a whole different area. So that is another separate section we'll be covering. So in storage, I'll be definitely covering S3, Glacier, Snowball, and probably I'll talk a little bit about storage gateways. Databases. Huge demand for Amazon RDS. Amazon is providing databases as a service. You don't have to employ costly database admins anymore. You don't have to buy big servers and pay huge licenses to Oracle or Microsoft for SQL servers and all. You don't have to do that. Amazon is providing databases just for you. You just go and create databases and start using it. You don't need to worry about patching the servers. You don't have to worry about creating clusters. You don't have to worry about your database backups, nothing. Amazon is providing you relational databases just like Oracle, MySQL, SQL Server. These databases Amazon is providing as a service. You just pay for it and use it. Amazon is providing database. This is a section where we will be covering. We will talk about it. I will show you how to create this. So you can actually go and create all these different databases and database services. You could take advantage of. You can create SQL Servers, Oracle, Postgres, MySQL, and this is Amazon's own. Aurora is another new technology. Now you can see that it is actually 5 times faster than MySQL. You can store up to 64 terabyte of auto scaling storage replicated. Great, great services Amazon is providing. So we will look into RDS. I will be covering quite a lot of topics in RDS. It is one of the most demanding and most powerful services that Amazon is providing as part of their cloud offering, RDS, relational database services. I myself is not a database guy, but if you are really looking into getting different type of database, so for example, if your company is having Hadoop and big data and all, you know, nobody uses relational databases. Oracle and SQL Server and all are relational databases. Yes, it is still widely used in the industry, but now with big data analytics, you know, so much of data, you cannot use relational databases anymore for massaging or creating different analytics out of this huge amount of data coming up. You know, just imagine Facebook will be getting how much data? I don't know. It is not even petabyte. It may be an exabyte of data they will be collecting every day. Just imagine, just you only think how many new images you uploaded to Facebook today, how many photos you shared today in WhatsApp. Every photo is data, right? It is not even 1 KB or 2 KB. These are big files, and you are even uploading a lot of videos. So much of data. Maybe you are planning to buy a BMW car. You might have shared the BMW photos to your friend. Your friend might have sent you a Lexus photo. You may be seeing, you know, all these are data now, and so much amount of data. But these data are very, very important stuff where you could create valuable information out of it. In order to do that, you need to have analytics. That is where big data analytics come into picture. When it comes to big data analytics, you know, you typically use a different type of databases like MongoDB or DynamoDB and things like that. These are non-relational SQL databases. Relational databases and non-relational or non-SQL, NoSQL databases, flat file kind of concepts. And then you can break that single big file into multiple chunks and do parallel processing or horizontal computing. So we'll talk about those things when we get on to databases. And, you know, in-memory cache, you know, just imagine, I still remember when I was in Bangalore in 1995, that is the time Windows 95 came, and, you know, the institute where I learned Microsoft, you know, they had a PC that was running Windows 95, and I created my first Hotmail account in 1995. So I had an Hotmail account, and even still today I use that. In 1995, I created my first Hotmail account. That Hotmail account, when I wanted to log in, you know, it takes probably like 5 minutes to get the homepage of Hotmail, and then you enter your username and password, it will take another 5 minutes. I'm not talking about a remote place in India. I'm talking about the Silicon Valley of India in Bangalore. This was the condition in 1995. It will take you like 15, 20 minutes to get your emails or to check your emails. Can any one of you think of that kind of a performance today? You have iPhones and Droid phones and things like that. You know, you are swiping your phone and you wanted to get your data come fast. You know, Facebook, you cannot even wait for a minute or even for a 20 seconds. You know, when you click on that, you want to see your video showing up. You want to see your thing. So, you know, you need that instant responses. You need that fast responses for whatever you're doing. So you're checking an email, you click on it, you should get your emails just like that. You're logging into Facebook, you should be able to see everything. You cannot have Facebook with the hourglass sitting to load all the messages. No, you cannot do that. But are you facing that problems? No, I don't think anybody is facing that problem today, because even though you have a good internet connection, that is not, you know, is that the Facebook application is able to serve those pages that fast? Believe me, guys, that type of service is happening today is because of this kind of elastic cache, in-memory cache databases. Many of these things are no more stored in the storage, in hard disk or anything. These are all stored in highly fast memories. Many financial companies, pharmaceutical companies, for their high-end applications are already started using in-memory applications. So that is another service Amazon is providing. Am I teaching that? No. Okay, I'm just telling you. But I will give you some ideas about it. If you want, you can go and learn all that. Redshift, you know, for data warehousing. I'll give you one example for this now. I'm sure this will be interesting topic. That's why I thought I'll tell you. 3 years back, in my company, we wanted to do some consolidation or what is it called? The wording, I forgot the word. You know, they wanted to combine 7 or 8 data, huge databases, into one single database or something. It is a data warehouse project. It's called as conversion. Okay, converting different type of databases into a totally new product. So it is called as a conversion. You know, those who know database, or is there any database admins here, you know what I'm meaning, data conversion. So we wanted to convert these huge databases, 7 of them, and convert it into a particular format and use it in the production environment from Monday. So we have a window of Saturday and Sunday. These are the only 2 days we can take the downtime. So in 2 days, we need to convert this huge database into a new format. In order to do that, you cannot use your normal servers. If we try to do it in a normal server with 24 CPUs and, you know, 64 gig RAM and all those things, it will take probably 2 weeks to complete, because that much amount of data needs to be processed. So we had an architectural level discussion in my office. We discussed, okay, how we can do this. So our goal is we need to finish this in 2 days. Can we do this in 2 days? That means we have currently around 48 hours. The goal was to complete this in 36 hours. Can we convert this entire databases into the format in 36 hours? Yes, we can. How? Buy some huge, gigantic servers. Believe it or not, guys, we bought 3 servers, each server with 2 terabytes of memory, around 20 terabytes of SSD flash hard drives, so many processors, and I think each server was around $150,000 or $200,000. So we bought 3 big, gigantic servers, and we were able to successfully complete that conversion in less than around 24 hours. The plan was 36 hours. We converted it in 24 hours. Remember, we paid around $600,000 to buy those gigantic servers. It was a one-time operation. We done, process is done, the project is successful. Now, what are you going to do with these servers? We spent $600,000 for this big server. They are sitting in our data center. Even today, it is sitting in our data centers as something nobody even use it. Amazon is saying, don't do that. Come to us. We have this huge Redshift thing, data warehouse technique. You come and use it. You want the 20 terabytes memory and 200 CPUs and all flash storage, I will give you. You could possibly finish your conversion in 5 hours in our servers because these are unbelievably bigger servers Amazon is providing. I don't know how they're doing it, but they have these type of gigantic servers. So now I can use Amazon Redshift and complete my conversion in less than 5 hours. And probably I may have to pay $100,000. That's it. I'm just paying for the amount of time I used. In Amazon, everything is based on time and the amount of time you're using and what services you're using. You're not buying any servers. They're telling, we are giving it as a service. You pay for the service, use it for 3 hours or use it for 5 hours and you go. I'm sure tomorrow, if in my company, if we wanted to do such a big conversion, we're not going to buy any new servers. We will use Amazon Redshift. We will use it for 5 or 6 hours, get our data converted, done, pay for whatever they charge, finish it. Look at the savings companies can make out of that deal. So databases in Amazon is a big deal. Amazon provides a lot of services. Another major thing is the networking. I told you, a cloud administrator, you have to understand about everything. Even as a cloud admin, you need to know database also, okay, to a certain extent. You don't have to be a DBA, but a cloud admin should know database also. You should know what are these databases. You should know how to deploy databases. You should know how to create databases and provide it to your application owners and stuff like that. So you're not only just a VM guy or a networking guy or a storage guy, you should also know databases. Anyway, networking itself is a separate topic, and we will be covering all that three topics, Direct Connect, VPC, and Route 53. What is VPC? VPC is actually called as a virtual private cloud. That is the core of this whole course, where you will be creating, or we will be creating, multiple networks in Amazon, creating subnets and different VLANs, and then you're creating complicated networks in Amazon, Amazon VPC. I think I have a picture to show you here when it comes to Amazon VPC. So I think I have a picture here. Don't get scared with this picture, but once the course is over, I'm sure you will be understanding this picture. So this is actually a typical architecture diagram of a company that has office in North America in two different data centers. So in the right-hand side, what you're seeing here, this is one of the company's data center. And this is another data center. This company has two data centers, corporate data centers in two different locations in America. And these offices are connected to internet, and then internet is connected to Amazon. When it comes to Amazon, look at this picture. You may be thinking, what the heck is this? How do I understand this? But believe me, guys, simple. Once you finish this course, you will be able to talk about each and every component that is in this picture. I can guarantee you that. You will be able to look at this. If I look at this picture, I know it's a very simple picture because I can easily see that, this is another one region. This is in Northern Virginia region. So this is region. Again, think about that, what I said, region. In the region itself, you have different availability zones, correct? Different data centers. So this is one AZ. This is AZ1. This is another AZ, AZ2. So in Amazon, in Virginia itself, they have two separate data centers they are using. And they have different subnets, and there are different networks here. And this is completely another Oregon. In Oregon, they have more servers here. You can see that they have a VPC here. They have a VPC here. VPC stands for virtual private cloud, a logical separation of your servers and compute in the cloud. It is pretty much like you are building a data center in Amazon's cloud infrastructure. A VPC cannot be extended between regions. A VPC can be extended between multiple availability zones, but you cannot have a VPC extended between two regions. That means you cannot have one VPC between these two regions. That's not possible. This is not possible because this is in Oregon, this is in Virginia. You cannot extend. So far, Amazon is not providing that. I'm sure in the next 1 or 2 years, they will come up with a technology where you could span your VPC or virtual private cloud data center across multiple regions. Right now, it's not there. It is within a region. But within a region, you remember I was mentioning earlier, in within a region also, Amazon has data centers. Anybody remember how many availability zones are there in Virginia? We looked at it. How many availability zones are in thing? Actually, we have four. So that is what I show. No, we looked at it. You know, we have four. Three was the picture that I showed. Right. You know, we had four availability zones. So where is that? Let's go here and take a look at that. Hold on a second. So if you go to here in Amazon EC2, you can see that they have four availability zones: 1A, 1C, 1D, and 1E. So where is 1B? So Irfan, you're right. Where is 1B? So actually speaking, Amazon has five data centers or five availability zones in Virginia. Virginia is their biggest data center. Virginia data center, or is also called as US East, or sometimes in some documentations you see that US standard. If somebody say US standard, or my servers are in US standard, or my servers are in Virginia, or my servers are in US East, that means it is in Virginia. Virginia is the first data center for Amazon, and then they expanded from there. So pretty much every services except few are available in Virginia. Virginia has actually today, as of today, they have five data centers: 1A, 1B, 1C, D, and E. But when you are a customer, you only get four out of five. Now, if you create one, you may be seeing 1B. But for me, 1B is not available. So 1B is for government. I'm not sure, Khalil. Is that true? I don't think so. But I think they have a separate, it's a zone. I don't think that's correct. You know, they have a separate region itself for government. It is not for government, if my understanding is correct.
So they're not actually separating the AZs. They actually have a completely separate region for the government, correct?
That's correct. So they have a separate region for government. It is called as VOV. I think we can find out that right here. AWS, let's find out. I think in this picture, one of this picture is showing that gov thing. Let me see, I can find out here. One of these pictures should have that. Let me see. Oh, it's not clear. I'm just trying to find out a picture. Let's see. Time is running out, guys. I think I still have to cover a lot of things here, but unfortunately, you know, when we start talking, you know, we'll stuck here. So I think we'll talk about that later, but just understand there is a separate region for here. So I think if you look here, this picture also is not showing. So these are all not clear. Okay. Okay, can you guys hear me now, Khalil? When I browse, I might have used my bandwidth. Can you hear me now?